What's up, Third Street? We are in the middle of this huddle series on prayer, and I am so excited to bring you one of my absolute favorite passages on prayer today. We're going to be talking about, of course, a nameless woman. Those are some of my favorite people to discuss in scripture. And so if you've got a Bible, go ahead and turn with me, or KT's going to have the passage right up here. Head with me to Luke chapter 7, starting in verse 36. It says, one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to have dinner with him. So Jesus went to his home and sat down to eat. When a certain immoral woman from the city heard he was eating there, she brought a beautiful alabaster jar filled with expensive perfume. Then she knelt behind him at his feet, weeping. Her tears fell on his feet, and she wiped them off with her hair. Then she kept kissing his feet and putting perfume on them. When the Pharisees who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know what kind of woman is touching him. She is a sinner. Then Jesus answered his thoughts. Simon, he said to the Pharisee, I have something to say to you. Go ahead, teacher, Simon said. Then Jesus told him this story. A man loaned money to two people, 500 pieces of silver to one and 50 pieces to the other. But neither of them could repay him, so he kindly forgave them both, canceling their debt. Who do you suppose loved him more after that? Simon answered, well, I suppose the one for whom he canceled the larger debt. That's right, Jesus said. Then he turned to the woman, and he said to Simon, look at this woman kneeling here. When I entered your home, you didn't offer me water to wash the dust from my feet, but she has washed them with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You didn't greet me with a kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You neglected the courtesy of olive oil to anoint my head, but she has anointed my feet with rare perfume. I tell you, her sins, and they are many, have been forgiven. So she has shown me so much love. But a person who is forgiven little shows only little love. Then Jesus said to the woman, your sins are forgiven. And the men at the table among themselves said, who is this man that he goes around forgiving sins? And Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. I know this sounds a little bit different from some of the other passages that we've talked about in regard to prayer, but there's a few things that I want to point out. See, this woman, from the time that she's mentioned in this passage, she never says a single word. It says that she wept over Jesus, that her tears flowed, and she used the drops of her tears to wash his feet. Now, it was customary at that time because people didn't have cars, right? They rode horses. They rode on cattle cars, or they walked through the streets in their sandals. And so their feet were dirty and gross. And so when they entered a home, it was customary that the servant of the household would wash the feet of the people that entered. And so when Jesus points out, you didn't wash my feet when I entered, what he's saying is, you didn't treat me like an honored guest when I entered your home, but she did. And then when he goes on to say, you didn't offer me a kiss, that's a customary greeting, right? A kiss on the cheek. He says, you didn't do that, but she hasn't stopped. And what I can't help but think of when I read this passage is the series that we just did on Hannah. Right? So Hannah, when we see her crying and weeping, where is she? She's at the altar. She is giving God her grief and her distress, and she is bowed before the altar, sobbing and praying. Right? It says that she went to God in the depth of her anguish. And this woman here, it says that she carried many sins. And what we see in both of these passages is that neither of those women utter a word. I don't know about you, when I'm crying, when I'm upset, when I'm distressed, there might not be words coming out of my mouth for the people around me to hear, but there's 1,000 things going on in my mind. We don't know whether or not Jesus had spoken with this woman or talked to her before entering this house. We have no idea. But what we know of her, because Luke went out of his way to say it, is that she had quite a past. She had quite a history. And when she encountered Jesus, it drew her to her knees, crying in worship, just like Hannah. And what happened to Hannah? The priest called her a drunk. He told her, get out of here with that nonsense. He said, how long are you going to be drunk? We know that she wasn't, because she defended herself after that. And in this passage, what happens to her? She gets ridiculed. The men are like, why? If you knew who she was, you wouldn't let her do that. This story appears in a different way in the three other Gospels, in Matthew and Mark and in John. And it's debated whether or not these are the same instances and they carry different details, or whether or not this happened twice in Jesus' ministry. But either way, the woman gets ridiculed. Her worship gets rejected by onlookers, just like Hannah. But what do we know because of who God is and what he does in Hannah's life? And what do we know because of what Jesus says? It's that he accepted that worship as worthy. Because when it comes to prayer, even when we can't say it out loud, even when we don't have the words, God hears it. God accepts that offering and God responds, because tired and exhausted hallelujahs rise to heaven just the same. An exhausted, tired prayer, word of praise, grievance, grieving, any of it, it's all accepted by God. Your prayer doesn't have to be perfect. And your prayer doesn't even have to be accepted by the people around you. This woman's wasn't, but she gave a beautiful offering. And in the other Gospels, when this same event occurs, Jesus says something else that is so beautiful. He says, wherever my story is told, her worship will be remembered. He says that she will be remembered for what she offered. We don't even have her name. The other Gospels, in this one, she's nameless. In another Gospel, she's nameless. In another Gospel, she's called Mary, right? And we don't even know which Mary. It doesn't even distinguish which Mary. Some people assume it's Mary, the sister of Martha. Some people assume that it's Mary Magdalene, because in Luke it says an immoral woman. But you know what? That doesn't matter. What matters is that Jesus accepts the offering. Your prayer is heard. Your prayer matters to God. Your prayer is received. And so what I want to know, and what I want to ask you today, is what are you holding back because you're afraid of the response of people around you? What are you holding back because you're afraid of how other people are going to look at you? What do you need to honestly lay at God's feet today? Like this nameless woman, like Hannah, who we talked about for so long at Third Street. What do you need to leave at the altar and not pick back up? Because the thing about that alabaster jar is she shattered it. She didn't take it home. In order to get the oil out, she had to be broken. What do you need to leave at Jesus' feet? Because I promise you, no matter how afraid you are to give it, no matter how afraid you are of the ridicule of people around you, Jesus will, he'll take it. He'll take that offering. And in Romans, it tells us that even when we don't have the right words to say, even when we don't know what to say, the Holy Spirit goes before us and speaks on our behalf. So not only is God there to receive your offering, but his Spirit is there to help you give it. You can trust God with whatever you're holding on to. Bless up.